It's a fair run. There's a great chance now to win the game, make it 3-1. He won't miss from there. Dennis Slaughter makes it 3-1. And Zambia now have one place in the semi-finals.
Been at the heart of Zambia. In fact, one would not be far from the truth to say Zambia was born a sporting nation. This is exemplified by the fact that the country got its independence from Britain in the middle of the Tokyo Olympics in 1964. And Zambia officially joined the Confederation of African Football, CAF, and World Soccer Governing Body, FIFA, soon after independence in 1964. Her initial international fixture game was an Independence Day celebrations friendly game against the Black Stars of Ghana. And since 1964, football has remained Zambia's number one sport. The spectrum of hue, tribe and creed of enthusiasts make football a special game in the hearts of many Zambians.
I simply love the game myself. The people love the game. When we are together at this Independence Stadium, as we call it, the unity of the nation is there. You can feel it. So it's really, it's in the blood of almost every Zambian.
Everybody's crazy about football. You're kidding? Crazy. Twice we postponed cabinet meetings just in order to allow ministers. First we brought a television in the meeting hall, and maybe nobody was looking quite properly. They wanted to get nearer and nearer. So we just said, well, cabinet adjourned. This is how much we love football.
It has no tribe on it. It's a, you know, small ball, and it bounces all over, and that brings us together.
But we forget our differences, we emphasize our similarities, and we're all passionate about it. Yeah, so that's good for the nation.
The love for the beautiful game in Zambia is from the ordinary Zambian right through to the presidency. Zambia's first Republican president, Kenneth Kaunda, typified this. The Zambia national football team was fondly referred to as KK11 in his honor. Masha Chilemena is a renowned football commentator who did radio commentaries and has warm memories about the KK11 squad.
You are talking about the KK11. The KK11 was like a piece of a meal saved on a golden plate. If there was no Dick Chama, there would have been Robert Lutoba. Stop, children. Bola yaya, umuntu ashala. Oh, umuntu ashala, the ball goes. At 6, Bonfest Fumanchu, Chitapo Chimo, chest master, Simtowe. The only player to have used three nicknames, Katwishi, in one soccer season. And the only player at midfield row to have won the Sportsman of the Year and the Top Scorer of the Year the same season. I don't know whether, Katwishi, you were born then, and my cameraman. That was in 1969. And then, of course, at shirt number 8, you had the midfield general, Johnny Simulambo, who was perceived to have been seeing the ball from all directions as if he had four eyes. If there was no John C. Mulambo, there would have been a Richard Stevenson, tall, lanky, colored guy, beautiful footballer, excellent, brought and born and bred under the Anderson late Mazoka's, you know, management as chairman of Magnificent Cup Warriors, who won literally every trophy in the Zambian Soccer League. What a player. Gibi Zulu, oh my gracious. Boniface Mtowe was assisted by excellent players like the computer Alex Chola, who was described a player who could not be understood by a manual computer unless a magnetic computer, because even his coach Anti Buselic or Sam Zumu Njovu would not understand what Alex Chola is going to do in the next 30 seconds from now.
And 50 years later, vivid memories of the team are still fresh.
Because the KK11 was a predictable team. Why do I say so? Predictable in the sense that even an old man in the village, let's say for example, my own father, the late Simon Chilemena, he could tell you that my son, today at 14 hours, when Zambia is playing against the Green Eagles of Nigeria, the lineup is Emmanuel Mwape, is Edwin Mbaso, Keisa Kalambo, Dick Chama, Dixon Makwaza, Boniface Mtowe, Moses Simwala, Janis Mulambo, Bernard Chanda, Godfrey Yukachitalu, Brighton Sinyangwe. That was a predictable lineup. Why? Because these young Zambians were just too good that it was not possible to make a substitution.
Our team was all-round team, because we had a lot of talent. Most of the players were good in all the positions that we were playing. So it was easy for the coach to get us around and play a good game.
It's the team which stayed together for a long, long period of time. And people would even recite the lineup before even the coach announces the team. That's why I'm sure people believe that it has been a great team ever produced in Zambia.
They were a committed crop of players. Please understand the background in which they worked. Most of them were declared amateur by government policy. Therefore, they did not make a living out of football. They had other jobs that they used to do. Are you with me? And yet, you should see their commitment. You know, the team used to camp at Independence Stadium in the dressing rooms, and they had army personnel coming out there to cook for them. You know, but today our players stay in five-star hotels. You know, they fly all over the place. They get thousands of dollars for poor performance and the rest. So that was a unique team.
This KK11 was massively, excessively, individually gifted, talented and skilled. It was fantastic to do commentary.
They were committed to each other. At that time, I think consistency is the word. We even got to know the team. You could call out the team when you knew Zambia was playing. You know, 1 to 11, you knew them all by heart.
Dixon Makwaza still holds the proud record of being the player to captain the Zambia national soccer team for longest tenure. Makwaza captained the team for 9 years, from 1962 to 1971. And when he decided to quit as captain, this did not go well with many Zambians, including First Republican President Kenneth Kaunda. Dr. Kaunda summoned Makwaza to State House to persuade him to change his mind. Dick Chama then took over as captain after attempts to persuade Makwaza failed. Makwaza, however, holds another enviable record. Documents attest that he is the only player in Zambia not to have gone in the referee's book. He never received a yellow card, not even a red card. And since 1964, thousands of players have worn the national colors. Godfrey Yukachitalu remains one of Zambia's greatest players after he scored 107 goals in one season in 1972. However, his prowess has not been acknowledged by FIFA because this feat was not documented.
He was a goalkeeper. If you remember, he's one of the strikers who scored more than 100 goals, 107 goals. So he was a goalkeeper. In every game that he played, he made sure he scored a goal or two. So that's what made him more famous.
Brave character who would break through tight defenses, and he had that knack of goals, and he used to score goals from without. That also has been a great achievement, though it has never been recorded.
Yuka was, under inverted commas, an animal when it comes to scoring. He is one the best player ever to be produced in Zambia as a striker. Chitalu walked scoring. Chitalu walked and running while scoring. Chitalu ate supper scoring. Chitalu slept scoring. Chitalu would be walking scoring. There is nothing that Chitalu was thinking about other than scoring, Katwishi. He was the best scorer of the 1980 Olympic Games in Russia. His goal, even if we lost to Russia by 3-1. I remember Dennis Liwewe in that commentary was saying Chitalu's goal was enough for human consumption. If it were some kind of a meal, it would have been a meal prepared on a diamond plate, on a gold, saved on a golden table. That was Godfrey Yuka Chitalu. Every time he told John Simulambo, Willy Piri, Richard Stevenson, or is it Evans Katebe or Freddie Kashimoto, let the bola be kapa, bring the ball to me, because I'm the one who knows how to score. Godfrey Chitalu was an exceptional goal scorer. Godfrey Chitalu was a criminal in scoring.
Yes, he was the highest scoring. His record has not yet been beaten. I think he scored something like 89 goals for Zambia in his entire football career, and nobody has even come close since then. Yeah. So he's good. I mean, he's got about 5 Football of the Year, Sportsman of the Year awards. Nobody comes close to him. Yeah. For me, it's the biggest thing that never happened international. If he had been given the same opportunities that today's players are given, Yuka would have been our idol today.
And on the international scene, Zambia entered the history book after playing in the AFCON final with the then Zaire, a game which took 48 hours to declare the conqueror. This was after a 2-0 draw on Sunday, but the game was only decided on a Wednesday and Zambia lost 2-0. The Olympics of 1988 remain a proud reference point in the history of Zambian football. This is because, against all odds, little fancied Zambia, which later became to be known as the Chipolopolo Boys, shocked themselves and the whole world when they conquered the mighty Italy by beating them 4-0 at the Olympics in a David and Goliath fashion. The antics of the Chipolopolo Boys wreaked havoc among the Italian Football Association members, so much so that they suspended the Italian league to facilitate for a post-mortem. The year 1988 goes down in the annals of Zambian football as the year Kalu Shabalala was crowned African Footballer of the Year. To date, he is the only player to achieve this from the Southern African region. Then tragedy struck. In pursuit of a maiden World Cup appearance, the plane carrying the beloved Chipolopolo Boys and other support staff crashed off the coast of the Atlantic Ocean in Gabon.
Daniela,
I knew all those boys by name, first name. We had worked together for a long, long time. And it was just indescribable. I couldn't believe it at all.
It was one of the saddest days of, you know, my life. It was, we lost all we had.
After I'd heard the news, on the, I think it was 11:30, and 12 o'clock, from 12 to 6, the phone never stopped ringing, you know, and I didn't even have time to, you know, to think and cry and everything, but I think about the boys all the time.
However, the nation soldiered on and a new team was reconstituted. Top on the agenda was to continue with the pursuit of a maiden World Cup appearance. That dream has to date eluded Zambia. And on 10th October 1993, Zambia played Morocco and only needed a draw to qualify to the World Cup. But alas, lost in the dying minutes of the game.
10th October 1993. 0-0, first half, closer again. And then Zambia had piled so much pressure. A counter-attack, I think it was 2-3 kicks, the ball was already in our goal area. And I think it was a gent, I can't remember his name, Dreed or something like that. He scored one of the most painful goals for me because I cried. I was at ZNBC that time and I wanted to see Zambia qualify. But what was more painful about this game is that this was the reconstituted team, remember? We had suffered a blow in 93, April. Now this was October, okay, and we were thinking, well, we will have some compensation, and what happened? We lost out.
Jean Fidel Diramba was the referee in that game, and to date, some Zambians still blame his handling of the crucial encounter for the loss.
So on the 11th of this of October 1993. Katwishi, ZNBC staff, me, Msenje Kapumpa, Elita Schiva, and Oswald Mutad, decided to organize a protest match to say Zambia was not treated well. And it became a very big protest. We marched from ZNBC to Anchor House, which was the headquarters of the Football Association of Zambia.
Born has made us angry. He gave a yellow card to Wawa Jamuna.
And I read a speech there, which I can still show you. What is interesting about this speech was that it was typed by Chibamba Kanyama. I still have it. Okay, he typed it for me, and I spoke on behalf of the soccer fans at Anchor House.
Without any doubt, Zambia could not disturb the day's demands for this cause if it were not worthwhile. About the unfair, indiscriminate, unjustified, and unequal handling of the game between Zambia and Morocco last Sunday. This so that Zambia go to the World Cup. Neither are we protesting against Morocco.
So that's how close and how painful it has been when we've tried to go to the World Cup.
The development of football in Zambia has not been smooth sailing. In 2011, the National Sports Council of Zambia declared the Kalusha Bwalya-led FAS executive illegal for alleged breach of the FAS constitution. And Zambia survived a FIFA ban after the Andrew Kamanga-led group organized a parallel AGM and was elected interim president of the Football Association of Zambia. The turbulences later minimized, and a year later, Zambia's dream of winning a major trophy was realized. This was after Zambia conquered Africa to win the AFCON for the first time. Zambia beat Ivory Coast on post-match penalties to be crowned African champions in 2012. The achievement was extra special because it was attained in the very country where those before this team perished in 1993.
And as Stopira was coming, and I told people that, look, even before this boy takes the penalty, I am donating the Zambian regalia, the cape, you know, the scarf, the t-shirt for Zambia, green, which had all our national flag. I donated all that and the tracksuit top. I gave it to the people. I was left skinned. Here comes a time that Jesus must declare victory. Jesus must declare triumphant into a winning arena. Now the Zambians will take it. And Stopira is the boy with the responsibility of more than 14 Zambians, you know, 14 million Zambians on his shoulders.
It's the number 13, Sunzo, scores! Zambia champions of Africa! Unbelievable! It's all over and Zambia have achieved the unbelievable. They're champions of Africa, they can't believe.
I don't know, you know, how high I flew in the air. I don't know, because people thought I was mad and crazy. Yes, I was mad and crazy because Zambia had been declared the winner of the 2012 Africa Cup of Nations tournament, beating the rest of Africa, all the 52 countries then before South Sudan joined in. I declared to everybody, Zambia has managed to conquer Africa. We have managed to do what Napoleon failed to do, to conquer the whole world. Zambia has conquered the whole African continent. Nobody is going to erase this history to date. As long as you talk about African football, you know, Katwishi and Zambia are referred to as the golden champions of 2012.
2012 was a good year for us, and I am glad that we managed to get to that point, because can you imagine just going out of this world and this life without a gold medal? The thought that I remember went through my mind is, I wish. I reflected on a number of friends who I knew were ardent soccer fans and ardent supporters of football who had passed away before that date. And kept saying to myself, I wish they were around. There's nothing better than that.
So, Stopira Nzuzu, how I wish then first, we should have told this boy, Stopira, Landa Mumushobo of your own clan, describe to us. They forced him to speak English. How I wished he would have been told to speak in Bemba. I can assure you, he could have said, ni umfabwino, nde umfabwino, nde umfabwino sana, elo nintemwa chakwebati, na ngukumuru nabishiba, kwati nintemwa, because naingisha penalty, ya kubali na po.
We are all prepared for this tournament, and it looks easy for us, but it was not easy. But the way we prepared, it was easy for us to lift the trophy. Because the intensive training we had in South Africa was very high.
The streets of Lusaka came to a standstill as thousands of Zambians thronged the streets to celebrate the victory.
Zambia is still playing fame. One Zambia, one nation. Who supports Zambia? Don't underestimate this jersey you are putting on. I love it. Zambia won!
And every Zambian was given chance to view the trophy, which went round the 10 provinces. Long queues formed as the trophy was taken to all the 10 provinces, and many defied long distances to have a glimpse of the coveted trophy. Zambia might have conquered Africa, but there is still a yearning for a World Cup appearance.
Well, I can only hope that the next 50 years, Katwishi, when this program is reviewed from the archives, that the people who will be leaving then will say, we have achieved more than the first 50. Because the first 50, to me, are very sad. Again, as I said to you, compared to the efforts, the resources that this nation has put together, we can't reward them only with one Africa Cup. Sorry. And never having gone to the World Cup, we can't call that achievement.
So as we are in development, we need the cooperation of everyone. Because when you are building something or developing, you take so many risks. As we are looking to the point of qualification to the World Cup, we will take so many risks along the way until we achieve our goal.
For the team to qualify, it's not easy to go to the World Cup. Because even best team than, better teams than Zambia, some of them haven't been there. So.
Hope still lingers among Zambian football devotees, as impossible is nothing and nothing is impossible in football.
Come on.